March 5, 1944, the Burmese jungle, U.S. Army 849th Engineer Aviation Battalion Camp.
"Get back!"
yelled 21-year-old Private Herman Perry. He stood in the road brandishing his M1 Grand Rifle. Lieutenant Cady ignored the warning and stepped closer. Sweating, sobbing, probably coming off an opium high, Perry was losing it, having a breakdown. He wasn't going to let Cady take him into custody. He wasn't going to do more time at the parasite-infested hellhole known as the Lido Stockade. Despite Perry's erratic behavior, Cady wasn't about to back off. This boy had a smart mouth. He'd been AWOL. He was a troublemaker. He needed to be punished. Besides, there was no way that Perry would shoot. That would be suicidal. Now less than a foot away from Perry, Cady stretched out a hand toward him. Bam! Cady jerked and crumpled to the ground. For a split second, everyone stared in disbelief at the fatally wounded Cady. Then Perry swung his gun around and trained it on the other officers as he backed away down the road. As he neared the trees, he turned and ran, vanishing into the brush. During World War II, the United States segregated its armed forces. Sure, there were a couple of African-American combat units created mainly for political reasons, but the majority of African-Americans who served were relegated to menial tasks including cooking, cleaning, and construction. That's how close to 10,000 African-Americans ended up being shipped to Burma. These men are stationed there to build what will end up being a boondoggle, a 1,072-mile supply road to run through the Burmese jungle connecting Lido, India to Kunming, China. Some 5,000 white Americans are also sent to work on the Lido Road. However, many of them are officers overseeing the black soldiers. The Burmese jungle is torturous. It's hot, humid, the vegetation's dense, the terrain is rough, it's easy to get malaria or dysentery, and it's hard to avoid the leeches, lice, and mosquitoes. Even worse, sometimes man-eating tigers lurk in the brush. Clothes rot, and the food rations are poor. Building the Lido Road is backbreaking, far harder than Perry's North Carolinian childhood of picking cotton in a sharecropping family. The soldiers have mandatory 16-hour shifts, bulldozers supplied by the army quickly break down, and the GIs are forced into manual labor. They use hoes and pickaxes to dig the muddy, rocky red soil. Many of the black soldiers work side by side and become friendly with coolies, unskilled native laborers. As a result, the black soldiers pick up bush lingo, Urdu, and Hindi. They trade in the local black markets for moonshine known as jungle juice. Some soldiers, including Perry, seek solace from the grim drudgery of their lives in opium and marijuana. When Cady was attempting to take him into custody, Perry was coming off a two-day drug bender. After shooting Cady, a panicked Perry runs into the jungle. Oh God, he killed someone! For 3 days, Perry stumbles through the jungle in a daze. Not knowing what to do, he veers back to the Lido Road. He runs into some soldiers from a different unit working on the road. They feed him and pass along messages from his friends in the 849th Battalion. Military police are looking for him. Perry decides to surrender. At nightfall, he stands by a bridge for the Namyung River. Sooner or later, a patrol will come by and he'll turn himself in. While waiting, Perry sits down his rifle. Hearing gunshots somewhere nearby, Perry gets worried the MPs are gunning for him and they'll kill him outright instead of arresting him. Spooked, he slips into the jungle again, accidentally leaving his gun behind. Perry spends several days wandering in the jungle. Luckily, he speaks some bush lingo, which allows him to beg for rice from Naga farmers. The Naga are an ethnic group native to northeastern India and northwestern Burma. Some of the tribes live remotely and stick to traditional practices, including headhunting. For the most part, the British and Americans ignore the Naga, as long as they stick to making war on each other and not Westerners. March 18th. Around 2 weeks after he'd killed Cady and fled into the jungle, Perry runs into some British troops. Perry, who's always been a smooth talker, thinks fast and makes up excuses as to why he's alone in the jungle. He's able to charm the Brits into giving him some food rations. It's hard going trekking through the remote Patkai's foothills, but the farther away Perry gets from the army, the better. One day, Perry's hiking up a dense mountain slope when he sees something spine-chilling, a basha, or a temporary shelter often made with bamboo. This basha is decorated with human skulls, to which water buffalo horns have been attached. Perry has stumbled into the head-hunting Naga village of Tumga. Believe it or not, Perry delights the villagers by giving them the remaining canned food rations he got from the British. The Ang, or village chief, invites him to be his honored guest. Perry takes a liking to the chief's 14-year-old daughter. She seems to return his interest. Perry has a new problem. How do you flirt with a girl and impress her warrior father when you don't know the culture or speak the language? The answer is gifts. Perry hikes some 8 miles down the mountain back to the Lido Road. Somehow, he manages to get a hold of a load of army goods. Most importantly, he gets an M1 Grand. In Naga culture, tiger pelts and claws are prized. The act of killing a tiger is seen as a virile feat of masculinity. Compared to the clubs and flintlocks the Naga have, with his modern gun, Perry is seen as having the ability to kill many a tiger. The village is impressed. Perry is considered an important man, and the chief allows Perry to marry his daughter. The first few months of Perry's married life are pretty good. He struggles with malaria, but due to his stockpile of army rations, he's rich enough to hire servants to work his fields. Perry spends much of his time hunting monkeys and tigers. He grows fluent in his wife's language. The couple's excited to find out that they're expecting their first child. Many nights, the tribal musicians play flutes and drums while the tribe chants, takes psychoactives, and dances. Meanwhile, the army has offered a 1,000 rupee reward for information leading to Perry's capture. That's upwards of $14,500 in today's money. They assume that he's headed for the city, so they've been searching for him in Calcutta. The legend of Perry is beginning to grow. Warranted or not, he's becoming a folk hero. To the black GIs who stew with the resentment of daily petty racial humiliations, Perry is awesome. Apropos of what actually happened, they see Perry as someone who fought back against the man and won. Eventually, Perry becomes homesick. When he was drafted into the army, he left behind a young daughter and a girlfriend in Washington, D.C. Also, his stockpile of rations is quickly dwindling. He begins to hunger for Western items, especially cigarettes. He hires runners to go down the mountain to trade at the black market in rural towns. Finally, the army finds a clue. In the summer, some 5 months after Perry vanished, a coolie finds the rifle Perry accidentally left behind when he panicked at the bridge. The army realizes they've been searching in the wrong place. They put out feelers in rural towns near where the gun was found. Eventually, a rumor reaches their ears about the chief of Tunga having a black soldier as a son-in-law. Army brass is incredulous. They never would have expected an unarmed tenderfoot like Perry to survive for so long in the jungle. A runner who had gone to the town of Namyong to get rice quickly comes back to tell Perry that there are men searching for him. Perry leaves his wife in Tumga and goes to Noksa, or a satellite village. July 20th. Captain Walter McMinn and a small posse of MPs, along with hired Naga guides, go on a 3.5-hour hike up the mountain to Tumga. None of the Americans speak any Naga. They use a picture of Perry and hand signs to communicate. The posse learns that Perry's gone to the Noksa. By the time that the posse huddles outside of the Noksa making a plan, it's twilight. The MPs get a guide to go ask Perry to borrow his gun for a hunt. The ploy works. It's a common request and Perry agrees, which leaves him unarmed. Army snipers sneak through the brush and position themselves around Perry's basha. They have to be careful. It would be diplomatically unwise to accidentally kill any Naga. While eating dinner, Perry sees flickers of light outside. The Naga don't have flashlights. It can only mean Westerners. Perry thinks about trying to sneak into the pitch-black jungle behind the village, but tigers have recently been a problem. He grabs a dao, or short Chinese sword, and lights a bamboo staff to use as a torch. Getting up his nerve, Perry goes outside. McMinn immediately blinds Perry with his flashlight, ordering him not to move. McMinn fires, but misses. Perry takes off, and the soldiers chase him, shooting as they go. Perry seems to vanish into the jungle, escaping the ambush, but then they find his body at the bottom of a hill. Perry's been shot in the chest. Around 10 p.m., McMinn hikes several hours back to Namyong to get a doctor and more soldiers. Even with the extra manpower, it ends up being a 9-hour ordeal to carry the stretcher bearing the 170-pound severely injured Perry down the mountain to reach Lido Road. From there, an ambulance takes Perry to the 73rd Evacuation Hospital at Xingbuyang. Perry spends the next several days recovering. While Perry's hyped up on morphine and other medical drugs, he's frequently interrogated. At first, he denies being Perry, but then finally admits his identity and confesses to shooting Katie. He's coerced into signing a 3-page document that he's told is a statement of what had happened. Though Perry thinks some key facts are missing or distorted, against his better judgment, he notarizes and signs the paperwork. On August 28th, Perry is deemed healthy enough to be transferred to prison. He's sent to the notorious Lido Stockade, the very prison he was trying to evade when he shot Katie in the first place. This is his second stint in the stockade. Several months before the whole shooting incident, Perry had spent hellish months in Lido, convicted for disobeying orders when an officer tried to assign him extra work. Though Perry's sentence for disobedience was 90 days, he'd been forced to serve an extra couple of weeks in the stockade without an explanation. The Army assigns Perry a lawyer, Captain Clayton Oberholzer. Unfortunately for Perry, Oberholzer only has experience as a civilian lawyer and has never handled a felony. The fact that Perry killed Katie is indisputable, but Oberholzer hopes to get the charges reduced from premeditated capital murder to manslaughter, the difference being life in prison versus execution if convicted. Perry is also accused of desertion and willful disobedience. September 4, 1944. Perry's court-martial takes less than 6 hours. Oberholzer fumbles a chance to get the sworn statement Perry made while drugged, tossed. He botches, explaining that the morning of the murder, a distraught Perry was headed to see Lieutenant Colonel Hyatt, the commander of the camp, who had an open-door policy to chat with the soldiers, white or black. Katie went out of his way to accost Perry with the intent to take him into custody, consciously seeking to prevent him from seeing Hyatt, who might have limited Perry's punishment for going AWOL. When Oberholzer brings up Katie's history of abuse toward black GIs, the tribunal warns him that Katie's character isn't on trial. The vote is unanimous. Perry is dishonorably discharged, must forfeit all pay, and will be hanged by the neck until dead. As part of the Army's due process, the verdict condemning Perry to death must undergo a review by 3 members of the Judge Advocate General's Department in New Delhi. All the way across the world, Perry's mom gets a letter from the Army informing her that her son has been court-martialed, convicted of murder, and is sentenced to hang. Bewildered and frightened, she scraps together some money and hires the best lawyer she can get. Her lawyer submits a brief to the Washington-based office of the Judge Advocate General's Department. The Washington office informs New Delhi that a brief for the Perry case will shortly arrive in the mail. Nearly a month later, on December 15th, the New Delhi office transmits a classified message asking about the brief. It hasn't arrived. It's been lost in the mail. Meanwhile, Perry has been stuck in limbo, imprisoned in Lido Stockade. He spent his time watching and memorizing guard schedules. Then, on December 15th, Perry makes his move. Late at night, he crawls under the rear of his tent. The sleepy soldier standing guard at the entrance to his tent doesn't notice. Perry only has 11 minutes before the next time the guards make a circuit. Using wire cutters he stole while on work detail, he quickly cuts a hole in the prison fence just big enough to wiggle through. Protected by strips of coarse wool cut from his prison-issue blanket, Perry crawls through the drainage ditches filled with barbed wire. After that, he runs through a field at the stockade's edge and disappears into the jungle. Sweet freedom. Perry stops to catch his breath. He's free, but some 80 miles of mountainous jungle separates him from his wife and unborn child. How's he going to get home? Army brass loses their minds when they realize that Perry has escaped. The Lido Stockade's warden and 8 guards are formally reprimanded for negligence. The Army again puts a 1,000 rupee bounty on Perry's head. They radio broadcast Perry's description in several languages and print wanted posters. By airplane, they drop some posters on the village of Tukumga. The illiterate Naga villagers collect them, impressed that pictures of the chief's son-in-law are falling from the heavens. MPs begin stopping black soldiers at random based on the chances that they might be helping Perry. Whenever they can, many black soldiers tear up the wanted posters. They enjoy swapping tales and rumors of the Jungle King. The law brief in defense of Perry finally reaches New Delhi on December 27th. The advocate judge's review finds some of the Army's actions questionable, but reconfirms the verdict of execution. In the wee hours of January 1, 1945, Perry is almost caught at an abandoned timber camp by a posse of MPs who had heard rumors of a black soldier hiding there. Luckily for Perry, he's a light sleeper and escapes into the jungle just in time. A bullet barely grazes him. The MPs recover a .45 pistol Perry accidentally left behind. February 19th. 2 black soldiers, Staff Sergeant Toomer and T4 Troxler, are buying liquor in the town of Makum when Perry suddenly storms the bootlegger's shack. Somehow, he's gotten a replacement .45 pistol. He mugs the 2 soldiers of 95 rupees and forces the bootlegger to cook him dinner. Perry asks Toomer and Troxler to do him a favor. He wants them to bring a truck stocked with rations, clothes, a tent, a knife, and ammunition in the next 24 hours. They agree to meet Perry in Makum the following night. Even though he stole money from them, Toomer and Troxler debate what to do. Ultimately, they decide to tell the Army, mainly out of fear of what could happen to them if the Army found out that they had suppressed information about Perry. They inform Major Earl Owen Cullum, commanding officer of the 159th Military Police Battalion at nearby Chauba Camp. Cullum decides to set up a trap. The soldiers will arrive with the truck and the Army will ambush Perry. Toomer and Troxler agree to help as long as the Army keeps it a secret that they betrayed the Jungle King. However, Perry has anticipated a trap. A crowd of coolies shows up to meet Toomer and Troxler. The Army doesn't see Perry, but even if he's there, they can't shoot without risking a diplomatic incident. Suddenly, from among the crowd, Perry sprints for the truck and hops aboard. He forces Toomer and Troxler to drive away down the road, but there's a snag. A checkpoint's coming up. Perry gets out of the truck to trek through the jungle around the checkpoint. Toomer directs Perry to meet them at a grassy field on the far side. Perry doesn't know that this is the Army's Plan B. As he reaches the field, MPs fire at Perry, but again he escapes into the jungle. This time he's wounded. A bullet nicked his right foot. He packs it full of moss so it won't get infected, a trick he learned from the Naga. Perry limps through the jungle and hides in a rice paddy. Hours later, he awakes to the barking of German shepherds. The Army's caught up to him. Perry escapes yet again. This time, the tip of his nose gets grazed by a bullet. He puts moss on this wound, too. Cullum receives a scolding note from his commanding officer for letting Perry get away. Cullum vows to capture Perry. February 22nd. A desperate Perry hides by the side of the Lido Road. His new plan is to board a truck, hide among the supplies, and hitch a ride over the mountains. When the truck reaches Burma, he'll ditch it and disappear into the jungle. But Perry is unwell. The gunshot on his foot is very painful. Also, he's had to drink river water and has caught dysentery. When Perry tries to hop on the back of a slow-moving truck, he's too weak and falls in the road, dropping yet another 45. The gun skids further away as it hits the ground. Perry realizes that a coolie has witnessed his failed hijack attempt. Spooked, he quickly melts back into the jungle. For the third time, he leaves a gun behind. Cullum starts a mobile posse to hunt Perry. He begins visiting town after town to question locals. He also coordinates with the British and native police forces. He and his fellow posse follow Perry's trail for over 2 weeks. Cullum eventually figures out that Perry's headed in the direction of the town of Namrup. Perry's following the southeastern branch of the Dsang River. It's a long, indirect route to Tunga. However, Perry's probably taking this way because just south of Namrup is considered the gateway to the Naga heartland. Here, Perry would be able to make friends. Chances are, some of the Naga tribes speak the same language as Perry's wife. Cullum realizes he has only a few days to catch up with Perry before he vanishes into a remote area again, maybe this time forever. Meanwhile, Perry's been growing weaker by the day from dysentery and malnutrition. He's surviving on stolen sugarcane and begging farmers for rice. Stupidly, Toomer and Troxler mention they're snitching on Perry to a colleague. The Army has to evacuate them from Asia over threats of murder from Perry's fans. After a long, rough journey, the posse arrives in Namrup. Cullum receives a tip as to where Perry is. He's staying at a rural farm a few miles away. The posse waits until nightfall before hiking to the farm. Cautiously, the posse fans out and surrounds the farmer's basha. They find three Naga tribesmen wearing traditional dhotis sitting by a fire outside of the home. Cullum senses that there's something not quite right. He takes a closer look at the men. He then grabs one of them. It's Perry. He cut his afro and borrowed native clothing, hoping that he can pass for Naga by firelight. For the last time, Perry is taken into custody. Under tight security, a sickly Perry is transported to the Chibua stockade and kept in an isolation cell. The Army decides not to return him to Lido stockade. They fear a potential racial uprising. Perry's interrogated by MPs who want to know where he got his guns. Perry refuses to snitch. He's sorry over Katie's death, but also says that he would have killed his pursuers if he had a chance. March 15, 1945. A few days after his capture, Perry is woken before dawn and under extremely tight security transported to Lido stockade. Per his last request, Perry is allowed to write a farewell letter to his brother Aaron and given a final cigarette before he's quietly hanged just after 7 a.m. March 17th. Perry's mother receives a notice from the Army informing her of her son's death by judicial asphyxiation due to his own misconduct. Despite repeated requests for information, she hasn't heard anything since her lawyer submitted the brief in December. She knows nothing of her son's escapades or anti-hero status. Some months later, a small group of black GIs are on an expedition through the Patkai Mountains to check for survivors of a crashed cargo plane. They hire some Naga guides and end up spending the night at a remote village where one of the guide's relatives lives. As guests, the GI are served a special treat for dessert, canned fruit cocktail. One of the soldiers curiously inquires as to where the cocktail has come from. The next morning, before they leave, the soldiers are taken to the only basha in the village, painted a bright yellow-orange. It turns out to be owned by the chief's teenage daughter. Inside, the walls are decorated with wanted posters of Perry. The dwelling is filled with a stockpile of army goods. The young mom proudly shows off her curly-haired 6-month-old son. Wow, that was a wild ride! And now that you reached the end of our video, why not keep the watch party going? For another crazy story of a soldier surviving in the jungle, check out the story of Aussie Robert McLaren, who performed emergency surgery on himself. Or if you're interested in famous battles, you'll enjoy our video about the amazing Battle of the Bulge. Don't wait. Click now.